Good morning. My name is Kiran Kumar. I'm a faculty in finance at International School of Management Excellence, a reputed B school from Bangalore. In today's session, we will learn about how to compute cost of equity applying CAPM model using MS Excel. Before I demonstrate to you on the Excel worksheet how to compute the cost of equity using CAPM, let me give you a very brief background very quickly about what the CAPM model is about. CAPM is an asset pricing model very famously and widely used by analysts around the world, despite a lot of its assumptions and limitations, of course. CAPM was actually developed by William Sharp way back in 1960s, and he even won a Nobel Award towards the same. To explain CAPM, let me give you a very an example like this. Let us say I want to invest in a stock. And I am considering whether I should invest in that or not. Okay, one of the simple analogy that I have to do is, okay, when I am investing in this stock, what is the return that I require from this stock? Okay, let's assume that there is a method to compute the required rate of return, and I require with some logic around 12% rate of return from this stock. Alright, so there is a stock, there is an analysis done by on this stock by some analyst who has applied a lot of security analysis tools. He has done a fundamental analysis and he came out with a suggestion that here is the stock which can earn you, expect to earn you a return of around 15% in the coming few years or whatever is the investment time horizon is. Right? So logic is simple. I need to, my requirement is to earn 12% return, whereas there is a stock which is expected to give a return of 15%. So naturally the stock is a buy for me, right? Because I will be satisfied with 12%, whereas the stock is going to give me 15%. Let's say the analyst has told that this stock is expected to give me 10% return, then I wouldn't have bought that stock because my minimum required rate of return is 12%. So unless the stock gives me 12%, I wouldn't invest in this stock, right? Now the question is, we understood the 15% part what the analyst has done, which is he has done a fundamental analysis, he has analyzed the economy, industry, he went to the company fundamentals, he went to the revenue model, business model and stuff like that. Whereas when it comes to my required rate of return, what is the logic that I should use? This is where CAPM approach helps us. What CAPM approach does is, it uses a principle called opportunity cost principle. So all of us know what is opportunity cost. Opportunity cost is a cost, or rather a return, that I would earn if I don't invest in this, which is my best next alternative available. Alright, so instead of investing in this stock, my one of the alternative, just for the discussion sake, let me say you can invest in a risk-free return, a risk-free asset. Okay, what is a risk-free asset? Risk-free asset is any asset where you are not taking any risk. Am I right? So if I am investing in a risk-free asset, let us say I will be able to earn around 6%. Just an example number, 6%. That means this stock what I am considering should be giving me at least 6% return. Am I right? Yes. So that means my minimum expected rate of return is risk-free return. I denote it with RF. Right? But will I be happy if this stock gives me only 6%? No. By default, by theory, a stock is supposed to be riskier than a risk-free asset like a fixed deposit or a bond, a government bond. Right? So that means by investing in this stock, I am taking some extra risk. Am I right? Yes. So for that risk that I am taking, I need a compensation. Alright? Unless the stocks give me something more than, okay, my example was 6%, right? So unless the stocks give me little more than 6%, alright, I wouldn't be investing in this stock because I have a best available alternative of risk phase. Without taking any risk, I am able to earn 6%. Point is clear? So that means I need something called risk premium. Now the question is, how much should be the risk premium? Alright? Now, what is my next best alternative over between risk-free asset and between this particular stock which has a certain amount of risk? What is my next alternative? My next alternative is, I can directly invest in the market, a general market, a broad market. Right? Let's say for example you are talking about a Sensex or a Nifty or any broad market index. What you can do is, you can choose to invest in an index fund or an ETF which invests proportionally in the Nifty index. Let's say for example Nifty index, it can be Sensex, it can be any other index that you are considering. Alright? So, if I am investing in the market, let us say for example, I would be able to earn, let us say around 13%. This is a random number I am giving you, just to give you the theory. So what is my return expectation now? My return expectation must be a minimum of 13%. Am I right? Not 6%, 13%. Why? Because instead of this stock, I can invest generally in the market and I can still be able to earn 13%. That's what is the return that Nifty is giving. Right? Now, this is what CAPM does. Right? What CAPM does is divides this 13% into two parts. Alright? One part is your risk-free return, whereas the other part is your market risk premium. Alright? Now, your risk-free rate you already know, which is 6%. That means market risk premium must be 7%. Am I right? Yes. So, risk-free rate of return can be earned by anyone, whereas market risk premium can be earned when you invest in the market. Now, let us try to modify this a little bit. Okay, let us say the stock that I am investing is either highly riskier than the market or it can be less riskier than the market. When does this happen? This happens when, let us say you are considering a stock which is a small cap stock, which is not part of the broad market. And all of you know, Nifty and Sensex, they take the top 30 or the top 50 stocks. Am I right? Now, top 30 or top 50 stocks by default are large cap stocks, which are mostly stable companies, which are in the mature life cycle of their growth path, alright? So these kind of companies will not be that riskier to invest than comparing to invest in a smaller company, small cap company, or even a mid cap company which is on the path of growth, alright? So investing in these kind of companies will be little highly riskier compared to that of the market. This is the logic behind risk premium, alright? Now, what I am saying is, if you are analyzing a company which is part of the broad market, whose return market risk premium is 7%, then we are talking about a beta of 1. I'll explain to you what is beta. Let us say you are considering a stock which is riskier than this, that means that risk measure must be higher than this, maybe 1.5. Alright? You may also have situations where you are investing in a stock which is less risky than the general market. Alright? Maybe you are a more stable company than the market. So there you may have a beta of less than 1 also. Alright? Now, this is my contribution from the CAPM. So, this market risk premium of 7% is a risk premium or the return, excess return that you would expect from an investment that you will do in a stock which is part of the market, broad market. Am I right? So, that means you are, let's say for example, this market risk premium, as I said, the return of 13%, you are trying to earn it on a broad market index like Nifty. Now, let us say you are analyzing a stock which is not part of this Nifty. Nifty generally has top 50 stocks of the market, Indian markets. And maybe you are analyzing a stock which is a small cap company which is not part of the Nifty. So, in that case, what would you do? Alright? In that case, the stock might be riskier than this. So, will you be happy to get the same 13% return even if you were to invest in a smaller company which is supposed to be highly riskier compared to the broad market? Stocks like Infosys or Wipro, am I right? So in that case, we are coming to one question called how to measure risk, right? So this is where we use a statistical method of regression, and we try to find out something called beta. All right. So what is this beta? Beta is very simply beta of, let us say for example, 1. What it means is the sensitivity of a stock's price to the market price can be said to be 1. It actually represents the slope of the curve when you regress the stock price into the market price, or in some cases stock returns to the market returns. Alright? So what does it say? When I say the beta of a particular company is 1, okay, there are two ways of interpreting it. Number one, when the stock price, sorry, when the market price goes up by 1% or 1 unit, the stock price is expected to go up by 1% or 1 unit. Similarly, when the stock price goes down by 1%, I'll correct myself. When the market price goes down by 1%, the stock price is also expected to go down by 1%. That means the stock is moving along with the market price movement. Mm-hmm. All right. Let me give you another example. Let us say beta of a stock is 2. Taking the same example, when the market price is going up by 1%, the stock price will go up by 2%. And when the market price goes up by 1%, comes down by 1%, the stock price will go down by 2%. Alright? So what is happening here? You are kind of measuring the market price movement, okay? And vis-a-vis, how is this stock price moving? If this stock price is moving more volatile than the market price, we can say that the stock is riskier than the market. By the way, reverse is also true. Alright? So beta is a measure, okay? A statistical measure which tells you how risky is stock price as compared to the market price. So by default, when you are taking this 30%, which comprises of large cap stocks, broad market stocks, the beta of these companies are expected to be 1 or around 1. But the stock that you are considering to analyze may be riskier than that, may be less riskier than that. Alright? So you need to actually compute the beta. Okay? We will see how to compute the beta later in the next session. But as of now, just understand that beta is the measure of risk. Higher the beta, higher would be the risk of the stock. Alright? Now that we have decided that we want to earn 13%, which comprises of 6% of risk-free return and which also comprises of 7% market risk premium. But what you want is a stock risk premium. The stock risk premium has to be an adjusted value of the market risk premium. Right? If you were investing in market, you would have been happy with 7% because 7% times the beta is still 7%. Let us say if you are investing in a stock which is riskier than the market, and let's say the beta of that particular stock is 2, that means the stock is twice as riskier than the market, then what you would expect is 7% times 2. That means you would expect a stock risk premium of 14%. Right? That means what is your total required rate of return? You want 6% to compensate you for not investing in the risk-free asset. You want 14% to choose to invest in this stock which is double the risk, which has a beta of 2 as compared to the market. Alright? So this is what the CAPM model is. Okay? To summarize this, what does CAPM equation look like? CAPM equation looks like this. Let us use the word RRR, which is required rate of return. I need risk-free rate of return. Alright? Plus, I need market risk premium. Right? As adjusted with the beta of the stock. And market risk premium can be redefined as RM minus RF. So what is RM? RM is the broad market return. RF is the risk-free rate of return. Alright? So this is the equation we go on to solve. Okay? Which basically tells me as an investor, what is my minimum required rate of return from a particular stock, given a specific risk-free rate of return available in the market, given a particular behavior of the market, and given the risk of this stock vis-a-vis the market risk. Right? So now that we know the CAPM model, okay, we'll take a case study of Maruti Suzuki Limited, which is one of the large cap stocks, and we'll try to measure the risk. We'll also try to take the risk-free rate of return. Okay? And in the coming session, I'm going to demonstrate to you how to use MS Excel to compute all these different factors. I'll also show you how to download the data. Okay? And let us see how to go about it in the next session. Thank you for watching this video.
Hi again, my name is Kiran Kumar. I'm a faculty in finance at International School of Management Excellence, a reputed B-school in Bangalore. Continuing the previous video that we have discussed about CAPM model and the concept of required rate of return, let me now show you taking an example of a stock for which we can calculate the cost of equity, and we will be using MS Excel as a platform to do the calculations. Alright, so before I begin, let me just give a brief of the equation of CAPM that we have considered. CAPM equation we devise like this, right? Risk-free rate plus the beta, multiply that with market return minus RF. Let me just zoom it a little bit. Right. Alright, so this RM minus RF basically represents the market risk premium. Beta refers to the risk of the stock vis-a-vis the market. Risk-free rate is a rate of return that you can earn on a risk-free asset. Alright, Now, to compute risk-free rate, we can either go to the RBI website, or you can just take the historical average risk-free rate of return. Because we are talking about my case study basically is on Maruti Limited, which is one of the major automobile company in India. So I will consider a rate of 6.1%, which is also the 10-year GOI bond rate. That means if an investor is interested in investing in a government bond, this is the yield that he can expect from today for the next 10 years on a per annum basis. So this is my risk-free rate of return. Now next I would need the beta. Alright, so to compute the beta, we will use the function of regression, for which let me collect some data. What are the kind of data that we need? We need the data of the stock prices of Maruti. I also need the index prices, and I will choose the index Nifty to do the computations. Okay, so let me show you how we can, there's a publicly available domain where you can collect the data. Let me say I'm searching in the Google, Maruti Limited historical stock prices Yahoo Finance, which should take me to the Yahoo Finance website. Yes, the very first website I'm getting is Maruti Suzuki's Yahoo Finance website's Maruti Suzuki page. Alright, so this is opening up this. So we have Maruti Suzuki, this is the current stock price, and historical data is selected already. Let me just go down a little bit. Yeah. Now, see, we have by default data between July 2016 2017, which is basically a yearly price. See, there is a challenge here. How many years data should I be collecting? It is said that because you are using regression here, it is said that if you have any observations between 30 to 60, that would be an ideal period. So what I suggest you is to take a 5-year data, okay, 5-year data that is starting from 25th July 2012 to 25th July 2017, and see, you can take the data for monthly, because taking 60 observations as daily prices will only cover the last few 60 days, which will not be reflecting the risk of the stock. Similarly, you can't take 60 years also. So ideally 60 months, which basically spreads around 5 years. 5 years is a justified time for us to understand how risky is this company. So I've chosen the date, I've chosen monthly stock prices, and I'm saying apply. Okay, so essentially I will end up getting this data. So now that I have the data of this, let me download the same. So this will open a new Excel data downloaded. Okay, now I'll just click on the downloaded data. So as you can see, I have various data available. Let me tell you, we don't need this information. We don't need this information. Let me delete this. And I have two prices here. First of all, ensure that this is arranged chronologically. As you can see, July 2012, August 2012, September 2012, and it goes on all the way till 2017 June, which is the last month, previous month. Alright, and we have these two prices. One is a close price, other one is adjusted close. The difference between close and adjusted close is Yahoo Finance has this feature that it adjusts all the stock prices for the stock splits and the dividends that might have been declared in this particular period. Okay, what might happen is when a dividend is declared, the stock price will go down. Similarly, when a stock split happens, the stock price gets divided into two. Alright. So what happens when you take close prices, suddenly on a day when the stock split happens, the stock price shows a return of almost 50% down, which is not practically possible. So we generally suggest you take the adjusted close price. So I'll delete close and I'll rename this as Maruti. Okay. Now for the same period of time, I also need the Nifty prices. What I'll do is I'll go back to Yahoo Finance site again. Okay. I will search for Nifty stock prices. Just a minute. So the very first site that I get is Nifty page. Okay. So we have Same thing, we have monthly close prices for the last 60 months, historical prices. So I'll just say apply. Okay, now that I have the stock price, index prices of Nifty for the last 5 years, I'll download the same and it opens another Excel sheet. What I will do is, I'll open that new Excel sheet which has the Nifty stock prices and check the date range. Yeah, it starts from July 2012 and goes on. And all I need is this column, right? I'll cut this, take it to the other Excel sheet which I am maintaining, and I will insert it here. So essentially now I have the adjusted closing prices for the last 60 months, which is around 5 years between Maruti and Nifty. I have this, right? Now using this, I need to compute the beta, right? So what we may have to do is, we may have to insert and calculate something called return relative of both of this. So essentially I'm regressing the returns of the stock on the market return. Similarly, I'll also calculate the return relative of Nifty. So return relative is nothing but current price divided by the previous price. So it gives me something called return relative. All I have to do is, I'll have to just copy this, paste it again. Okay. So I have the return relative columns on which I can do the regression. Okay. One of the easiest method to do regression is to use a slope function. Please also remember, when you are calculating beta, you are applying this regression equation y equals a plus bx. Where y is your dependent variable, in our case it is the Maruti stock price, stock return. Then x is your independent variable, which is your Nifty index price returns, return relative. And a is the constant or the intercept, we might call it intercept, whereas b refers to the beta coefficient or the slope. Right. So using these essential features, let me calculate the beta. Now beta will be, okay, you can use the function called slope in Excel, okay, wherein you have to give the known y's. Y, as I've already defined, is the Maruti stock return relative. Okay, let me select that. That will be my y's. Okay, I have got that. Okay, comma, known x will be the return relative of the index price. Okay. And close the bracket, press enter. So we get the beta as 1.75. Okay, this is an easier way of calculating the beta. But also let me tell you, at this point of time, what we are working on, this data is a sample data. That means we have taken the sample for the last 5 years. We are working on sample data. Now, how can we assume that the same 5 years measurement that we have done of the risk can be assumed to be continuing for the next 5 years or 10 years? Now, that needs a statistically proven beta number. So that is why we want to do a hypothesis testing for the regression. All right. So how do we do it? We may have to use the data analysis tool pack available in Excel for the same. Let me select data analysis tool pack. Okay. And select regression. Okay. And input y range. Now let us give the input y range here, which is my stock prices of Maruti. Then let me give the x range, which is my return relative of the stock price. And then let me press okay. I'll get a new worksheet that opens up along with the results of the regression. Now I've got the results of regression. Let me just quickly run through what are the important factors that we need to be observing when we do this. Okay, let me highlight this with a color so that you know what are the things that you need to interpret. Firstly, multiple R represents the correlation between these two variables. Alright, you know what is the meaning of correlation. It says that both Maruti prices and Nifty prices are positively correlated. The correlation number is 0.75. Similarly, R squared tells you the strength of the relationship between these two. That means like the number here is around 56%. That means 56% of the variation, I repeat, 56% of the variation in the Maruti's stock returns is explained by the variations in the Nifty. That's what it means. Higher the better. R squared, higher the better. Another thing that I would look at is the significance F for the ANOVA model that I'm doing. Alright. So this should be less than 0.05. What this signifies is the relationship that is being established. Okay. The relationship that is being established between these two variables from the given sample is not because of chance. That means there is some logic why these two are behaving together in a particular way. This, as when we say it is less than 0.05, that means it is not occurring because of chance. That is point number one. Okay. Now, because we have only one variable here, which is your Nifty prices. Okay, the same significance F test will be also be the p value here. All right, so it is a significant. So whatever beta that we are studying here is a statistically significant beta that we can consider. That means we can safely say that at least with 95% confidence that the beta that we have calculated using the sample 60 observations can be taken to be reflection of a generalized population behavior. Okay, that is what we have assumed, and that beta we see is 1.75. Alright, so now this, let me take it to my original calculation sheet here. So my beta will be 1.74889 or 1. I'm just rounding it off to 5 digits here. Okay, now let's come back to what else I need. I need market return. Now the market return, again I'll go back to the market. Anyways, I've already downloaded the data for Nifty. I already have this number. Yeah, here I have the Nifty return relatives. All I need to do is I can calculate something called CAGR, okay, which can be calculated using the function geomean. Okay, and remember, when you are using geomean function, you need to use the return relative. Okay, so I calculated the geomean. All right, so geomean is it says 1.01%. Okay, 1.01, that means 1 rupee would have become 1.01 if you have invested for 60 months. But percentage return will be, when I do minus 1, I get the percentage return. Let me convert this into a percentage. So the percentage return on Nifty has been 1.08%. Note that this is a monthly number. Alright, this is the monthly return that has been generated by Nifty in the last 60 months. But again, in our calculations, as you know, risk-free rate, for example, is an annual number that we have got. So we may have to convert this also into an annual number. So how do I convert this? I will use the function called effect. Okay, and the nominal rate is 1.08% into 12 months. And number of n per y refers to the number of compounding frequency, which is also 12. When I enter this, I get the number as 13.77%. This is the annual compounded return that is generated by Nifty. I'll copy the same thing to my original calculator, which is 13.77%. Given this, the required rate of return of Maruti Limited will be, going by this equation, my risk-free rate of return of 6.10% plus the beta of 1.75 multiplied by the RM, which is 14%, I mean close to 14%, minus the risk rate of return, again 6.1%. This is my expected, let me convert this into percentage. This is my expected, my required rate of return if I were to invest in this stock today. That means if I'm investing in a risk-free asset, I'm happy with 6.10%. If I'm investing in the market, I expect 13.77%. And if I'm investing in Maruti Limited, which is 1.75 times more riskier than the market, I expect 19.51%. This also goes to prove that higher the risk that you're taking, higher is the return that you would expect. Okay, hope this video has been useful to you. Please practice it using a different stock, different case study. I'm sure it's quite easier and conceptually clearer once you do practicing. Alright, thank you for watching this video. See you in the next learning video. Thank you.